friends out in Cable Land. This is another Seasoned Citizens production, and we have an unusual guest today. We have a father and his daughter who are both pilots. So Wayne Todman is our main pilot here, and his co-pilot is his daughter, Debbie Hutton. Wayne, before we get into the program, I'd like to say that I was familiar with your dad's airport down there in the old Stewart Road. A good friend of mine, Bob Barger, and I used to ride our bikes down there, and we got a big kick out of them doing vertical banks. And when they'd take off in their cars, we'd go into the hangar and sit in the airplanes and work the controls, and we just really enjoyed that. Wayne, I know that that's probably how you got your start, and I believe you told me you took your first ride at a very tender age. Tell us all about that.
Well, John, back when I was 6 weeks old, I had my first airplane ride with my father. And in fact, my interest in aviation grew from, I presume, that early date. And I was actually raised with aviation. We had the, as you mentioned, the airfield on the farm down the old Burlington Road. And Dad really was Mr. Aviation, I think, in the Muscatine area. He started flying back in the early 1932-33 era. In fact, one of the current pilots in Muscatine, Bob Frymuth, who is still flying in Muscatine, he has two airplanes at the airport. Dad taught him how to fly back in 1933. So this goes back a few years, John, and I came into the picture and started actually my training in 1961 and on my own. And this is my 25th year of aviation, and went through and finished my commercial training, my instrument training, and multi-engine. In fact, we have flown everything up through a Learjet, and aviation is really, really in our family. As we get into the program, you'll hear that not only Debbie and I fly, but her brother Doug is an air traffic controller. My younger brother is a major in the Air Force right now. So,
Wayne, I used to visit with your father, Roy, down there on the Burlington Road when he had the television radio shop. Mm-hmm. And he told me he raced in the Chicago air races when he was at a tender age, about 15. And I believe you can tell us about some of his other exploits flying around here.
Well, John, most people remember, of course, the old high bridge, but he's one of the, I think a couple people have done it, but and I'm sure that this is something we wouldn't want to do today, but he, one of the few that looped the old high bridge years ago. And he was a barnstormer. He used to go not only through the Midwest, but much of the United States barnstorming and putting on shows, and as you mentioned, doing a lot of racing. This was something I never really had an interest in. Mine was more or less to get from point A to point B. But Dad was, he was an adventure type of individual. He really wanted to go out, and he was one of the early explorers in aviation and one of the earlier pioneers.
While we're on the subject of your dad, tell us about that recognition he got a few years ago from the service.
Well, Dad flew Liberators, B-24s, during World War II. He flew the hump over in the India-China area of World War II, the theater. 34 years was the time lapse from the time the incident happened, and he happened to be at the VA hospital in Iowa City and was recognized that he had never been issued what he had earned, the Distinguished Flying Cross. He had a mission that was, at that time, considered suicidal. It was, you're going there and chances you're coming back are very remote, but as Dad has done throughout his lifetime, surprised a lot of people, he accomplished the mission and returned. And the old Army Air Corps, this was prior to the Air Force, is what he was in at that time, recognized his accomplishment, and the local area gave him the recognition that he didn't get 34 years ago.
I'm glad to hear that, Wayne. And by the way, I was in the China, Burma, India theater over there too, but I had a very easy job. I played piano, dance, and show band, but I was very well with the hump. In fact, they wanted us maybe to go over to China, but General Chenault said no. He needed ammunition and equipment more than he needed a band. So we were well pleased with that decision. Well, Debbie, I can see how you come about being in the flying business. Tell us about how you really got started in learning to fly and flying around with your dad and all those good things.
Well, I've been flying ever since I can remember. I can't think of the age, but it's been for quite a while.
Knee-high to a grasshopper.
Yeah. And we've flown all over the country, and well, I've just enjoyed it.
I believe your dad had a story about one time he wanted to look at the charts, the maps, on a trip, and tell us what happened when he asked you to take over on the controls.
Well, Debbie promised me that she didn't want me to tell that story today.
Well, just say that everything turned out all right.
Yeah, well, I can put it one way. I just decided, you know, a couple years ago when I got my license that it was time for me to do something, and I just decided it was time for me to get my license.
What kind of a plane did you learn to fly in on here at the airport?
Piper Tomahawk.
That has a high tail, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Two-place.
Right.
And tell us what the takeoff and landing speeds are.
That's about 70 knots.
And that's pretty fast compared with the old days, isn't it?
I guess.
Of course, you don't know about the old days. I got to learn in a Rocket Chief down there, and it landed like about 50 miles an hour, which is fairly slow. Well, anyway, you have your own plane now, do you?
Mm-hmm.
And what kind of plane is that?
It's a Piper Arrow.
Is that, how many places is that?
It's seats four.
And what would that cruise at?
About 160 knots, well, miles per hour.
What's your total flying time now?
Just over 100 hours.
Well, Debbie, do you have any ambitions about getting other licenses?
In my future, I would like to get my instrument rating and commercial license also. And then twin engine is in there somewhere too.
Well, Wayne, speaking of instrument ratings, you told yesterday about there are only it's a small percentage of the total pilots in general aviation that have instrument ratings. Tell us about that.
Of course, there are hundreds of thousands of pilots, and only 15% of the licensed pilots have an instrument rating today. And most of the pilots on general aviation are what they call VFR pilots, visual flight rules. Of course, the percentage is much higher when you get into, of course, commercial and military, because all of those pilots will have a instrument rating. But in the general aviation field, 15% of the total pilots have an instrument rating.
Well, Debbie, tell us about the modern teaching methods they use in ground school now. I believe they have little hand computers, is that correct?
Right. That'll tell you a number of different things that you would need to know. Like, I could go on for a while about it. But it can give you your different ground speeds with your comparing air speeds to your actual airplane speed.
I believe they're important for navigation too, aren't they?
Right.
Okay, well, Wayne, I know that you were affiliated with Kiwanis for a long time as a pilot. Tell us exactly what your affiliation was there and how you used an airplane in that position.
Well, back in 1967, I was appointed to the international staff of Kiwanis, which is a service organization, and my position with them was a field representative traveling throughout the United States and Canada. I'm sure most people that do any traveling at all know that the airlines go into the major metropolitan hubs, but they don't go into the smaller airports or smaller communities. And with my position, it was necessary for me not only to go into the major cities, but into smaller communities. And driving was almost, when you go from Muscatine to, say, Portland, Oregon, it's to your advantage to fly. Well, we found that flying myself by private aircraft was the best way to get into all of the areas, not only the major hubs, but smaller communities. So it was my decision, with the support of Kiwanis, that we flew an airplane from Muscatine throughout much of the United States and Canada. And I have over 5,000, in fact, I'm working on 6,000 total hours now, and a good percentage of that time was gained while I worked for Kiwanis. And it was 12 years.
Wayne, I recall an article in the Muscatine Journal about an experience you had on a mountaintop out in the western state. Tell us when that occurred and what happened exactly.
Well, John, what you're referring to was back on January 18th, 1970, a date that I don't think I'll ever forget. As we were talking, I was working for Kiwanis, and I'd been working in Montana. And my next assignment was down in Colorado, in Denver. And it was a Sunday evening when I made the decision to fly from Billings to Denver to be prepared for a Monday morning meeting when the weather again was really not of concern. We took off approximately 7:45 from Billings heading toward Denver. Now, I'm sure you and probably most of the folks know the geographic area that the Bighorn Mountains of Wyoming and into Montana stretched along that route, and I was on the east side of them heading toward Denver when a little over an hour into the flight, I noticed some of the gauges were not reading what they should have been reading. And the air traffic controller, I was on under control of the Denver Center at the point, and they gave me immediate permission to change course, which my desire was to go to the closest airport, which was Casper, Wyoming. So I changed course, and Casper approached, contacted me, and was under their control. And to go to Casper, though, I had to go across just the fringe area of the Bighorn, where I was flying on relatively flat terrain. I had to go over some mountainous areas. And no sooner turned toward Casper when what we call the manifold pressure, which is the gauge and the actual operation that makes the prop go around, the manifold pressure dropped to zero. And that means when you have a single engine airplane, you got a problem. Well, anyway, we set it into a glide. Of course, we did about everything we could do other than get out and work on it to try to get it going again. But as we found out later, there wasn't anything I could have done about it. But we set it into a glide, and as I looked outside, and of course the moon is fairly full, I could see the terrain was awfully rough down there. That wasn't too reassuring of a feeling. And it was coming up to meet me just about as fast as I was going down to meet it. In fact, my night vision could see right ahead of me that there was a mountain ridge and I was below the mountain ridge. So I pulled what we call the airplane into a stall or a high angle of attack, which is pull it right back up. And I made contact with the mountain ridge 5 feet this side of the top or the ridge. Glanced over the top, and in fact, I made one of the shortest field landings I've ever made in my lifetime, John. From point of impact where I came to rest was 150 feet. And I took a $33,000 aircraft that I had only had a little over a year, and they sold it for later scrap for around, it was $1,350. But the good Lord was with me because the only thing that really was intact in that aircraft in the wreckage when it came to rest was the seat that I was strapped into. In fact, all I had to do was take my seat belt off and step out, and I was on the mountainside.
Wayne, tell us how you got rescued.
Well, Casper Approach Control, as I mentioned earlier, had me under their control, and they were tracking me. And from the time I made contact with the mountainside, they had two rescue aircraft circling me. Had what the old call it old Beach 18, Beach D18, and a Skymaster. And ground crews, it took them, it was pretty rough terrain, John. It took them a little over an hour and a half to get up to me in an all-terrain four-wheel drive vehicle. And in fact, the first gentleman that came up to me was a highway patrolman. He came running up to me, and he looked at me and he said, were you alone, first of all? And I said, yes. And then he just stopped, and in the moonlight, he looked over the wreckage and looked at me and he says, young man, you just came through a miracle. He couldn't believe that I was alive, let alone walking around talking to him. And people ask me if I ever went into shock. Well, I guess maybe I'm still in it because I have full recollection of the accident, but I'm sure the shock was a part of the incident. But I can go back and I'll tell you, John, I have memories of this, and like I said, the good Lord above was there, and or I wouldn't be here talking to you today.
I agree with that. God truly blessed you that at that time. Now, Wayne, I know that on account of that experience, you decided to switch over to twin-engine airplanes. Tell us about what you did
well,
in that regard.
Well, John, it was shortly after that that I went back to Kiwanis, and they, again, gave me a little time off, needless to say, again, because of the incident. But I decided doing nighttime instrument flying, that it would be to everybody's advantage, particularly mine, to get two engines. So we scattered around the United States, and I'd only had a single engine rating at that time. So and I found an airplane I wanted in Oklahoma City. So I traveled down there, and in the negotiation to purchase the aircraft, they said they'd put me through their school. So I went through their school, and in 2.5 days, the training prepared me for my check ride. And as most people will know, Oklahoma City is the headquarters for the Federal Aviation Agency. So they had an examiner make an appointment with me on a Saturday morning, which I don't know if you folks through September and the first part of October, we got a little rain. Well, it was foggy and rainy that day, and the gentleman came in and asked me if I was instrument rated, and I said yes. So he said, well, file. So I took my check ride for multi-engine under instrument conditions, and won't go into the details, John, but after I was checked out by the examiner and signed off, I had my new rating, I got in my new twin-engine airplane, and it's pouring down rain. If you think about cotton in your mouth, I had cotton in my mouth. I took off with a new airplane, a new rating, heading back to Muscatine. And
Wayne, what kind of an airplane was that?
That was a twin Comanche, my first airplane.
Yes. We had Pete King on, I call him Sky Father. He's a lay preacher, and that's I believe he flies a similar airplane. Well, Debbie, you have a brother who's in the service. Tell us about your brother and what he does in the service and where he's located now.
Okay, he's a corporal in the Marines. He's been in for about 7 years. And like Dad said, he's in Okinawa right now. And he's certified to run approach and departure controls in the control tower. And when time allows, he's wanting to get his pilot's license also.
Well, now he also has, like you say, has been in 7 years. Does that indicate he's a career man that wants to get 20 years and then retire?
He's got about a year to decide whether he's going to stay in or not.
I think you better correct that. He's a sergeant, Debbie, not a corporal.
Hey, kill me. Moved up a little bit instantaneously there.
Okay.
Now, I believe your husband is even in aviation. Now, that's Bill Hutton.
Right.
Tell us what Bill does.
He's a lineman down at the airport, and he's got his private pilot's license, and right now he's working on getting his instrument rating.
Well, I'd say the Todman family and the Hutton family are the Mr. and Mrs. Aviation of Muscatine, it looks like to me. Well, now, Wayne, in regard to this Kiwanis job, I remember I was down at the airport one Sunday just visiting, and you came in, and you informed me that you had gone on a mercy mission down to Kansas City. Tell us about that mission and what the good the Kiwanis could do for people in situations like that.
Well, John, what you're referring to is we had a family here in Muscatine that they had a death in the family, or the individual was close to death, and the family wanted to get down to see them. And this was the middle of the night when this first call came through, and it was early in the morning when we took off to take the family down to Kansas City, realizing at the time that they called there was no possibility they could get on an airliner, and of course the short time that they had to go right now. And so we were able to provide a service for them. We could probably tell you of half a dozen other examples where we've had the opportunity to serve the people of Muscatine in emergency conditions. Another one I can remember was to Storm Lake in the Thanksgiving evening, where a call came through at midnight and there was an accident in the family and they had to have someone there immediately. And the weather seems like any time these accidents and incidents happen are pouring down rain or foggy or whatever, but we're more than willing to do so. And I'd like to also say, John, that there's a lot of pilots in Muscatine that are in the position where they have done this too. In other words, I'm not the only one. There's any number of Muscatine pilots that all you have to do is to give a call to them or down at the airport, and if there's an emergency, I'm sure they're ready to jump in their planes and help.
I recall that you had to go on a similar flight not long ago to Las Vegas. Tell us about that trip and the total flying time, the advantage of a charter flight, you might say, in that regard.
Well, John, what you had was a very sad incident where we had a gentleman that was murdered in Las Vegas, and a very good friend of mine, his brother here, they had a difficulty having his body brought back to Iowa, called me and wanted to know if there's any way I could help, because they're having difficulties in getting it scheduled to come back. So this was a Sunday evening, approximately 10:30, when I received the call from my friend, and he asked me if I could fly out, and I said yes. Well, John, to actually go through it chronological in time, I give Debbie's husband, Bill, a call and ask him to get the airplane ready. He left and went down to the airport and got the airplane ready. I called a friend of mine, Bob Lamb, here in Muscatine. He got out of bed and came down and gave me all the apparatus that I need for the trip. And at 20 minutes to 1, I also called a friend of mine who was a licensed pilot, instrument mulling engine, to fly as co-pilot, because that's a middle of the night and long trip, to come down to the airport and fly with me as my co-pilot. But anyway, at 20 minutes to 1, we had wheels up and headed for Las Vegas. And the actual flying time, John, as you mentioned, was 9.7 hours from Muscatine to Las Vegas back into Iowa again. And, of course, we had time on the ground at Las Vegas, but it was a quick trip. That's the shortest I've ever stayed in Las Vegas, but it was one of course, different set of circumstances. But here again, we were, it was a sad trip for all concerned, but at the same time, we felt that, we were glad we could help someone. And
well, that's commendable, Wayne. And I know you went into other kind of flying after you left Kiwanis, which involved explosives. Tell our viewers what that all involved.
Well, of course, aviation, John, is you fly people and you fly freight, and there's people that aren't too intelligent like me that fly explosives. not really. In fact, really, flying explosive is safer than what it sounds, because everything is stabilized before you take off. We flew contracts for the United States government where we would go and fly into places like China Lake, California, Los Angeles, Mojave, into Yuma, Arizona, Albuquerque, Tucson. On the East Coast, we'd go to Windsor, Locks, Connecticut, Akron, Fort Gordon, Georgia, Huntsville, Alabama. But we were flying all the time, ammunitions. And John, our biggest threat was not the ammunitions exploding, it was terrorists. In fact, this was one of the concerns that the government had and we had, in that we had to have an armed guard aboard all flights. And I'm not one where, I'm a very cautious individual, but the company I worked for decided to save a little money that they would arm the pilots. So my co-pilot and I, we carried 357 Magnums underneath our coat. So here again, it was a little different type of aviation where we had to be the pilots plus guards.
Wayne, did they check you out on those guns and target practice and all that stuff?
I have been through school, yes, John. I've been through safety school and also certification to be able to carry the aircraft or the weapon. But
now, was that in affiliation with the ordnance plant there in Burlington?
We flew for the ordnance plant, but it just wasn't theirs. We flew Hughes Aircraft, Hughes, I should say, Corporation, was one of the main contracting companies that we flew for. And this was just a government contract, and we were licensed by the government to fly explosives. In fact, we could probably use up the rest of the time of telling you incidents and stories of flying these across the country and into military installations, because that's where we went with 90% of our loads. We'd leave from one point to go into a military base or post.
Well, Wayne, what do you see as the future for general aviation? And I mean by that corporation pilots and in regard to opportunities for young people like Debbie and any other young pilot out there that might be watching. What are the opportunities in that regard?
Well, John, the aviation field is a growing field. It's one in which I can give encouragement to the youth of today for not only flying, but there are mechanics, there are other supporting areas. As Debbie's brother, Doug, is in air traffic control. These are all exciting, very needed supporting roles for aviation. Aviation is a field that is on the grow. General aviation is one in which I think through the deregulation of our airlines, which most people are familiar with, that there's been quite an expansion in not only commuter aircraft, but in just general aviation. And corporations have recognized the value and the need for flying.
I saw an ad, I believe it was in our shopper, in regard to charter flights from our airport here in Muscatine. Tell us what the advantage of those charter flights are to the public wants to get someplace in a hurry.
Well, you go on your schedule, not the airline schedule, first of all. You have the opportunity to go into the community in which you want to visit and not have to go into a hub and then rent a car or have someone pick you up and drive you miles. And again, it's a time saver and it's a dollar saver. So Muscatine Airport is a full service airport where they not only give training, as Debbie received her training, but they have the charter flights that you're referring to and also ambulance flights that are available.
Now, I was up to Cedar Rapids for the big Rockwell International Air Show, and I was quite impressed with how that was conducted. Can you tell us anything about those pilots like Leo Launslager and Charlie Hilliard and Bob Hoover and those guys? Do you know anything about how they get involved in those air shows and about their pay and any of those angles?
Well, most of them come back through military, and they got into aviation through testing, experimental. Most of the companies that they work for are either in radio or in manufacturing of aircraft. And of course, they go out and show the capabilities. And most of it is thrill and chill, so to speak, of what they show. But in all reality, what they're doing is showing that the aircraft is a safe industry. And again, I think this is a thing, if anything else comes of our visit today, John, safety in aviation is the biggest concern of all that are involved in it. And Debbie can tell you that she doesn't do anything unless she's sure that her training has given her that and experience has given it. And these people that you're referring to are the same way. They're showing that the aircraft are safe, they're showing the capabilities of the aircraft, and their background has been, to that point, in testing and one in which before they come before the public, they know what they're doing.
Right. Well, Debbie, what's the longest flight you've ever taken when you were in the left seat, which is the captain of the plane's position?
I flew down to St. Louis International Airport.
And that's a pretty good size airport, isn't it?
It's pretty big.
Now, when you approach an airport like that, what's the procedure on the radio and so on?
Contacting your approach control when you're so many miles out, and they'll give you direction as to where they want you to go and what they want you to do.
When you arrived there, did you have any problem with the airline traffic?
Not really, no. I'm sure it was around, but...
Well, sometimes they have what's called wind shear, isn't that right, Wayne? That causes problems not only for small aircraft, but for the larger ones, too. But you didn't get involved in any hazardous situations, I take it?
No. Wind shear is one thing I've been lucky enough to stay away from so far.
Well, Debbie, what would you say to any ladies listening on the air today about getting into aviation if they're so inclined?
Well, anybody can do anything they want to do, and all you have to do is set a goal for yourself and reach it. And mine was flying, and I got to where I wanted to be, and I've still got more flying that I want to do. So,
well, very good, Debbie. And Wayne, we're at the end of the program, and I just want to thank both you, Wayne, and Debbie for being on with us today. And it's been very enlightening, I feel, for our viewers. It's been interesting, and we're going to have a lot of pictures dubbed in that everybody will enjoy seeing, I'm sure. And I again thank you on behalf of the Commission on Aging. And that concludes our program for the day. And remember that good old slogan, do unto others as you would have them do unto you.